Welcome. It's my enormous pleasure, of course, to have my dear friend and long-standing colleague Sarah Jack with us for today's Hunter Center seminar, which is on entrepreneurship and the moral obligations from being embedded in place. Sarah's the Jacob and Marcus Wallenberg Professor of Innovative and Sustainable Business Development at the House of Innovation, Stockholm School of Economics in Sweden. She was also for a long time Professor of Entrepreneurship with LUMS, where she was head of department and associate dean. Her research interests are in entrepreneurship and social networks, and she uses social capital and social network theory to extend understanding using qualitative techniques. She's currently holding the five-year leadership role for the Academy of Management Entrepreneurship Division. Just a glutton for punishment, Jack, aren't you? And the paper that is being presented today is with a team whose work a lot of us have come to like and respect very, very much, with Ed McKeever and Alistair Anderson on community. So without further ado, I shall mute myself, welcome you all. Lovely to see people here from so far afield, and give the floor to Sarah.
Thanks, Sarah, for that lovely introduction. And thank you as well, everybody, for having me today. It's a pleasure to be back in Scotland. Just to give you some context, I grew up in the very north of Scotland. So my accent, I think, is still quite strong. When I hear myself speak, I'm quite horrified at how local to the north I hear myself to be. Haven't been away now for quite a period of time. But I started my academic career at Aberdeen University with Sarah Dodds and Alistair Anderson, both of whom were involved in the supervision of my PhD, and I've remained very close colleagues and such good friends. So after finishing, after my PhD and working at Aberdeen, I then decided to move to Lancaster University and the entrepreneurship department there within their management school. And then in 2017, I think it was, I joined Stockholm School of Economics, where I've also been engaged in supporting the development of the House of Innovation, which is a kind of new creation within SSE. And also taken on the role of lead for one of their NISM platforms, which is the sustainability arm of SSE. And the platform I lead there is business development through entrepreneurship and innovation. So to give you some kind of ideas of the work that I'm involved in and the kind of breadth and extent of some of the projects that I do, I thought it might be quite kind of useful to set the context in that way as well. So the first is a project which has just started, which is called Targeted MPI. And this project is designed to consider transparent and resilient gender equality through integrated monitoring, planning, and implementation within the context of business and management schools. It's a Horizon 2020 project funded through the EU with partners in Greece, Sweden, UK, Lebanon, and Belgium. And it's very much around gender equality planning, and that one's just kicking off now. We're starting to lead on a work package, so my head is just minced, as we would see in the north of Scotland. The second project is titled The Public Procurement of Functions, a Stepping Stone Towards a More Sustainable Future. And this project is funded through a Swedish foundation called the NMW Foundation. And it's a project which is with Linköping University and SSE. And it's purposefully designed to kind of strengthen efforts in finding sustainable solutions for the future and looking forward at procurers, organisations and SMEs, and obviously that's where I would kind of come in as well there, which are involved in this process. And there is the third project is titled Recirculate. And the Recirculate project, which Nigel is also engaged with, offers a new partnership-based approach to enable African researchers to grow transformational impact through working with and for their communities and developing robust, durable, equitable partnerships with UK researchers. So instead of working on Africa, the project purposefully looks to work with Africa through building collaborations and exchange. And I think that's the bit that I particularly like, the fact that we're working with our colleagues in Africa and building long-term collaborations. And that project will look to deliver innovative solutions to pressing problems with water use and safety. And water tends to be the thing that kind of keeps everyone together within this project, I suppose. And Recirculate really kind of joins up the different ways in which water sustains communities, from sewage disposal to energy generation, water used in food production. And the science that's going on and that we're seeing within that project is absolutely amazing. And the final project is one that's just actually finished up, which is called Simra. And it was another Horizon 2020 project, which involved 26 partners from across Europe and the Mediterranean countries. And it was very much around looking at social innovation in marginalized rural areas, And our role there was to develop a social innovation practice guide and what was called an innovative action case study. So these are some of the projects that I've been involved in. And I think what kind of makes me get involved, and which probably brings them together, is that kind of notion of collaboration and working with other people, but also working with other people from different places. And that's something that always I really kind of enjoy. But I think it's really nice that you can see that the impact of these, particularly within these different places across the world. So with that in mind, I'm now going to turn to the paper which I'll talk through today, which is called Entrepreneurship and the Arc of Responsibility, the Moral Obligations from Being Embedded in Place. And this is a paper which is under review at the moment, which is with Alistair and Ed. So it's quite nice because we haven't worked on something for a couple of years now, because we've all been quite busy doing other things, but the follow-on to the JBV paper and the ERD paper, so it's a nice one to have been involved in. And in this paper, we argue that entrepreneurship is embedded in places and that the social situatedness, it influences how entrepreneurship is practiced. And we propose that being embedded imposes a moral obligation to place and a greater sense of social responsibility. So our socialized explanation of entrepreneuring as a practice highlights how context is interwoven, not simply as the site of interaction, but that entrepreneurs using the resources of place bring about change. So our starting point here is really the work of Professor Barbara Gray, who is an organizational theorist based at the Pennsylvania State University in the US. And we heard her present her work at an invited conference last year on ethics and place, which was led by Helen Hall, Amory Ryan, and Honor Brownsey and Susie Pegar. And in her work, what Barbara describes is how partnerships are formed to bring about change, but also how they are shaped by context. And we strongly agree with her statement, but what we do here is propose that an entrepreneurial account of partnership may enable us to answer her questions about the influence of the characteristics of place. And we believe that reframing her statement is, in entrepreneurial terms, sheds some light on the issues. So we understand entrepreneurship as an engine of change, but recognize that entrepreneuring is itself a socially embedded practice. So rather than a social endeavor, our view is that entrepreneurship is socially enacted. And as a performance, we argue that entrepreneurship is always staged in a place. So we believe that place can be perceived as a critical part of the entrepreneurial process. So what we do here is take the view that places are the arenas of social interaction, and the partnership we employ is the social situatedness of entrepreneurship. Sorry, I'm losing my voice. So how entrepreneurship is embedded in place, and then how it is collaboratively achieved through social interaction and networking. And it's this partnership which we employ, which we think is particularly interesting. So we looked at Dr. Barbara Gray's own inclusive but encompassing style of using answers, so understanding and theory that normally resides outside the explanatory reach of the discipline. And our arguments are really quite transdisciplinary, drawing on insight to create a conceptual framework to address the questions she poses. And basically our argument is fairly simple really, but unlike typical spatial entrepreneurship theory, it centers on place as context, not just as a milieu for interaction, but as part of the entrepreneurial process. And we argue that entrepreneurship is embedded in places and that the social situatedness influences how entrepreneurship is practiced. And we do propose that being embedded imposes a moral obligation to place. And it's this ethical imperative that we believe shapes the dynamics of the relationships and tends to support the mores and the rules of the game that the institutional field, that are the institutional field of place. And I've tried to capture kind of different scenes within the pictures, but I always come back to the rural and more peripheral, I'm afraid. So I know I'm in good company when I say here that place matters for entrepreneurship. And I know that a number of people in the audience would take that kind of view as well. The places are where life unfolds and where entrepreneurship happens. Creswell explains place is seen as bounded, full, unique, and subject to forms of interpretive understanding. places are where values are created, possibilities are processed, and responsibilities generated, but also ethical and moral obligations are set in partnership with place. And place is overlaid with meaning, subjectivity, emotion, and effect. And belonging to place influences how individuals and groups behave, and such behaviour impacts on communities. So I suppose what this does is enforce and reinforce particular types of cultural practice and behaviour. And we do believe that while places are the physical conjunction where social values are manifested, things always happen in places. Places are stable but not static, and change occurs as a continuity from the past. And if you think about the work of Stamm and Belter, it tells us entrepreneurs engage with and enact their spatial context. So they do context. But entrepreneurs may be emotionally attached to place and what to do right by that location. And I think that the work of Sorensen tips his hat well to this point too. But what this means is that this attachment to place extends beyond an individual perception of place as a location that can simply help them, help entrepreneurs to achieve their individual goals. Belonging to place creates individual responsibilities to that place. And as Marcus and Batalina put it, entrepreneurs operate within the realms of place, bound norms and social identities of place. So moving on, in its relationship with place, perhaps best seen as a partnership with place, entrepreneurship can showcase the uniqueness of a place and why it is worth preserving. Indeed, according to Creswell, places are profound centres of human experience. And there is no knowing or sensing a place except by being in that place. And to be in a place is to be in a position to perceive it. Whiteman and Elves argue that organisations do not make places on their own. And instead, organisations shape places along with institutions, people and the environment. And in her body of work, Barbara Gray speaks of traditions, the spoken and unspoken rules of the game, what they are and who changes them, and also the boundaries of place. And the actions people take in a place will largely be influenced by how they perceive place and what they value about it. Yet also place will be influenced by its tradition and how things are institutionalised. Place is not produced by its local community on its own, but instead by the nature of relationships which develop within place. And it is these relationships which we would argue often creates an attachment to, even a passion for place. This is something that I think resonates well with Alistair Ed and myself. And if I think back to who I am and where I grew up in the very north of Scotland, that place and its rural community still matters to me. I still have connections to that place and feel bonded with it as a location. But this primarily is because of the social connections and experiences, the social history and the social understanding of the area, both as a place and of a social and as a social space. So place attachment can play a key role in supporting the development of self-esteem, self-worth, self-pride, but also social well-being. And that being said, place attachment can also be a factor inhibiting social mobility and individual progress, and can often work the other way, especially for people growing up or living in peripheral and rural areas where they do not fit in or can't adhere to social norms. And this we should never forget, it doesn't work for everybody. For example, Anderson et al. Recount how a newcomer's entrepreneurial efforts to improve a declining place were really challenged by different perceptions of that place. So if we turn to kind of embedding matters in place, and in her work, Barbara Gray questions what connects to what? What are the rituals and the power relationships brought about through being embedded in a place? And to address these questions, we need to establish what is really meant by being embedded. So to address this question, we trace the roots of the concept of embeddedness. And McKeever et al. In 2014 attributed the origin of the concept to Polanyi in 1944. To describe and interpret the influence of social structure on the functioning of exchange arrangements. And from these insights, a broad range of disciplines have developed the concept, often as a counterpoint to the atomistic economic individual who responds locally to economic signals. And a key theme is that embeddedness, identified broadly as the nature, the depth and extent of an individual's ties into an environment, community or society, can be understood as a configurating element of general economic process. And the early sociological literature brought out how connected individuals share a condition of community. This community of affective belonging has been exposed by sociological scholars in terms of structural and moral congruence, for example, the work of Park in 1924, shared understandings of mutuality and insiderness, Weber 1922, 1946, sharing of group identities, Simmel 1950, appreciation of within group rights and responsibilities, Holmes 1961, and adherence to protocols of behaviour and reciprocity. And this view sits well with our perception that entrepreneurship is a social process with economic outcomes. And Hall makes the same point, but shows that it can even have outcomes which are social. So we firmly believe that the social contextualization of entrepreneurial agency leads to a sense of community responsibility and an obligation to place. Embeddedness means being enmeshed and entwined in the social and economic fabric that constitutes place. Indeed, the fabric is made of social connections, and this is partnering in and with place, interwoven as the fabric of relationships where people know and understand what they can and should not do within a place. And with this comes a moral obligation to do the right thing and to do the right thing by place. But this understanding of how things work only comes about by being socially embedded. So if we turn now to this kind of thing that we class as the arc of responsibility. Now we take the view that social embeddedness and local social capital bring a local sense of responsibility for entrepreneurs. Like a moral compass that directs change but also acts as an arc of responsibility. And we argue that connections to place occur through being embedded and are interacted through social networks. But we see embedding as acting like a moral anchor. Place, through operating as a social space, shapes what is legitimate, what is appropriate, and brings with it expectations for how entrepreneurs should behave. And this moral anchor for doing the right thing is manifest in the way an entrepreneur behaves within a locality. The organisations entrepreneurs create do not exist in a vacuum devoid of connections to actual local locations, and that's been demonstrated in work through a number of people as well. So instead, entrepreneurship is socially situated and social connections to place are critical. The impact on the way the entrepreneur behaves, but also provides social legitimacy for entrepreneurship. And this intimate connection comes with a moral responsibility of being seen within the locality to do the right thing. And examples of how this partnering between entrepreneur and place plays out might be, for example, where an entrepreneur who during an economic downturn has little work for their employees, it keeps them busy with non-essential tasks. Why? Because they have mortgages to pay and the entrepreneur feels a moral responsibility to keep their employees in work. And it doesn't really matter what form that work might take. The main thing is to keep people busy so they in turn are earning. So financial situations of the individual employees are maintained in place and employees do not lose out. And we speculate that this kind of behaviour is widespread and builds a local social capital, which is very mutual. If push came to shove, the entrepreneur referred to in the example above would feel that they could turn to their employees and hope to see some kind of moral obligation, a two-way process of give and take in obligations of place. But we also see this as a kind of moral obligation, which from an ethical perspective seems the right thing to do, a simple virtue ethic. So while this moral obligation acts as an anchor which fastens the entrepreneur to place, what it also does is act as a compass to bring about appropriate change. Even though the extent and scope of change might be regulated by place and its institutions, we believe the compass often takes a moral direction. And throughout, we have kind of advocated for a more socially situated view of entrepreneurship. And while entrepreneurship might offer economic outcomes, it's being a socially situated practice means that non-economic values do not sit apart from this process. Instead, they become a part of its process. And this contrasts with the more kind of a spatial opportunity type perspectives of entrepreneurship and moves towards a more socialized understanding of practice. So if we take sustainable entrepreneurship as an example, we know little about how the sustainable entrepreneurship journey unfolds, particularly in a local context where entrepreneurs face different place-based expectations and thus different degrees of social legitimacy in their operating of place. But capturing the extent and nature of the entrepreneur's attachment to place and the extent to which they care about the community in which the entrepreneurial activity is embedded, we might extend understanding about how the journey unfolds. So our main rationale is that the absence or presence of place-based social legitimacy shapes the emergence of sustainable entrepreneurship, but that a sustainable entrepreneur's place attachment influences their ambitions and ways of managing legitimacy, challenges in a local community. This resonates with Barbara Gray's thoughts on the qualitative aspects of connecting and driving understanding about what connects to what. And given our view on entrepreneurship, we see this as increasing the likelihood of sustainable, but also ethical value creation, where the entrepreneur wants to protect local ecological resources, but at the same time enhance local social outcomes and social conditions. But we see sustainable entrepreneurship in a much broader sense and believe that through the partnering that we describe as existing between entrepreneurship and place, sustainability also relates to the social practice of entrepreneuring and sustaining communities and societies through time and in place. So our socialized view of entrepreneurship provides examples of types of entrepreneurship which happen because of a strong emotional attachment to place and the wanting to do right because of such an attachment, which often extends beyond place-based entrepreneurship to place-attached enterprising. And change lies at the heart of entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship itself is a change process. And entrepreneurs do things that bring about change. Entrepreneurs do entrepreneurship, but places are the recipients of the outcomes of entrepreneurship and intrinsically a part of the process of entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship in practice is context bound, and work has shown that context matters. And our earlier kind of work identifies the impact of entrepreneurial revitalization on specific places. But our view of partnering shows a way around this. Indeed, entrepreneurship is something that makes things happen and brings about change. And what such change might bring about is the repositioning of entrepreneurial purposes, generally and towards a sustainable future. And it might even be that directing entrepreneurial intentions to place can fulfill local obligations. And I've got a reference here to the recent work by Sarah, repositioning entrepreneurial purposes generally towards a sustainable future. And I've kind of included that there because Sarah's work, I think, is really interesting because it reflects on where we are at. And I think it provides a really interesting reflection, and it's already being picked up across the kind of group of entrepreneurial researchers who are particularly interested, I suppose, in entrepreneurship as practice, but also more kind of epistemological foundations. So Sarah, we might return to that in the questions. So we kind of call this managing the pendulum, the arc of responsibility. And Dobell in 2012 coined the term arc of responsibility to describe the responsibility that goes with a set of abiding interests and challenges. And in the application of the term here, we see a circular process in embeddedness, a process of drawing from the local environment and giving to the local environment and the entrepreneur. And when you're embedded in place, especially a small place, you can see things more clearly, the overlapping relationships and implications actions can have. For example, making employees redundant while standing at the school gate beside your expensive car does not work well for this kind of partnering. There's a moral dimension of embedded agencies because agency is embedded in place. And how it manifests is on the arc of responsibility. And what we often witness is entrepreneurs wanting, maybe even feeling the need to give something back to place. Entrepreneurs who have this moral obligation will not look to harm place. They see economic progress and social well-being are one and the same thing, part of being local, and understand the challenges, but also the responsibilities and obligations. And we argue that entrepreneurship carries with it this thing. And we see this thing as being a social obligation, which is generated through a moral obligation for doing the right thing. So if someone is embedded in place and does business in place, they will take from place, but also we hope look to give back to place. And entrepreneurship research typically treats community as a background context, but we concur with emerging views that move community beyond context and more to being a critical player in place and the dynamic practices entrepreneurs immerse themselves in. And we are not proposing in any way that place determines, but we are suggesting it exerts a powerful influence in decision-making and creating opportunities. And this is important because the nub of entrepreneuring is making decisions. Decisions about what resources to use and how to use them. And whilst an economic perspective might see these decisions as largely informed by economic rationality, a broader appreciation, a socially informed understanding recognises the effects, for better or worse, of embeddedness. And embedding works to create a social responsibility, a moral obligation to place, and we keep kind of coming back to this, and this frames decision-making. As Barbara Gray explains, frames are not just cognitive devices carried around in our heads, but are interactional achievements, as entrepreneuring is social, is socially enacted. So to conclude, what we offer here is a push to look to establish what this greater sense of social and moral responsibility actually means for entrepreneurship in places. But we also focus attention on the moral obligations and ethical practices that place often enforces on its entrepreneurs. Now, most change management looks at organisational change and how we can influence change. Indeed, this is the practical problem that this body of work mainly addresses. Put more broadly, how can do organisations maintain continuity with change? And the literature explains the strategies and stratagems that try to realign organisations to keep them relevant. So we have noted the several parallels of entrepreneurship or with entrepreneurship, especially in practices and processes. And we have noted how the inertia and stickiness of place, where place as a kind of organisation, resisted change. And we saw how culture and institutions framed what was possible, but also what was legitimate. And moreover, our socialized explanation of entrepreneuring as a practice highlights how context is interwoven. So it's not simply as the site of interaction, but using the resources of place to bring about changes to place. So in organizational terms, place obviously situates, but is also the carrier, the input and the output in change processes. And given these similarities, it becomes easy to see why some scholars have approached change management with an entrepreneurial solution. However, despite the appealing illusion, we are not persuaded by the illusion. And certainly entrepreneurship as a means, it's a mechanism, even a driver of change, and there are several similarities to processes. And what I've done here through the discussion of the work that we're doing and the analysis has shown many kind of likenesses, but also shows a fundamental difference. Change management is about changing existing organisations, but entrepreneurship is about creating new organisations with change and making abilities. New venture creation is about starting afresh with change as a purpose rather than an impediment. And of course, as we saw, change cannot be entirely novel. It is tethered to, and anchored in the institutions that represent the values of context and place. So in terms of a future research agenda, we think this opens up some interesting questions. How, for example, can organisations be entrepreneurial? What impact might such entrepreneurial change have on the small peripheral community in times of crisis? And what COVID-19 might offer as a return to place and return to the rural. But what we believe we are also witnessing is a shift quite rightly to a social moral obligation and the arc of responsibility. And on that point, I think I will finish and say thank you for being so patient and quiet. Thank you.
Thank you so much. A round, I think, of virtual and literal applause. That was just fabulous, Sarah. Thank you very, very much indeed. it's not my paper, it's our paper, et al, co-authors. Thank you. I'm going to throw this straight open for questions because I know that Caroline has a good one. Caroline, why don't you unmute and ask your question?
I've got Ed here to back me up.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, McKeever, Sarah's done enough of the work, kiddo. Over to you for a bit.
I told him about it last night, so.
Hi, thank you very much, Sarah. A really lovely speech. I'm currently sitting in Inverness, so not too far from your heartland, it has to be said, and on a sunny day. I'm just really curious, and I'm doing something similar on the other side of this, which is how place actually from a psychological, historical, social aspect actually constrains rather than emboldens and allows. And obviously I'm doing work in rural as well. And it's something you don't want to say. And I'm just curious on any work that you feel directly addresses that or any thoughts on how you understand and are honest about how we all can be honest from a research perspective, from the constraining factors as well as the enabling.
Yeah, and I think some of the work that Ed and I have been involved in before and Alistair as well kind of touches on this, but I think you're right. I think place can constrain. You know, it's not all good. In an early paper that Alistair and I did, I remember that we mentioned somebody from a small community who, you know, being an entrepreneur, had, for the external view, been doing very well, but actually the reality was very different, and that individual committed suicide because he couldn't cope with the, you know, the impact of losing face within the rural area. And I think that, you know, that is a side that we probably don't deal with as much as we should. Also in the presentation just now, I mentioned, you know, if you don't fit in, what do you do? I mean, I've got friends who have moved away from where we grew up, would never go back, you know, no kind of bond, no location. They might still have family there, but no real kind of will to engage. And these are close friends who would have been in the kind of same social circle to me, but I feel very, very different. And I do think that there's things that are there. On the other hand, something that I was in touch with somebody who I haven't been in touch with for years through Facebook. And it was really interesting because that was somebody who stayed in the local area and in their late 50s has moved away. And actually, when you see what they're doing now for the rest of the world, and yet they stayed very kind of located in their area, trying to do good there. And only now have they kind of stood back and done something for other places. So I think you're right. I think there are constraints, and I think there's some interesting work to be done there as well. Ed, I don't know if you've got examples as well.
Yeah. So out of our work with you and Alistair, I've been invited to do some work for Donegal, Sligo and Leitrim. So three rural county councils in Ireland. And really, they've asked us to look at the barriers and the drivers of entrepreneurship in these peripheral places. And really, a big thing in terms of constraint we've been talking about is culture. Very often, when your parents send you to secondary school, send you to university, they want you, and this is in the quote of somebody from Ireland, they want you to get a good pensionable job. And so then they talk about the types of people who become entrepreneurs. And very often they become entrepreneurs for not just a financial reason or an economic reason. Very often they do it because it's seen as to help out others. And so people get more status out of helping others rather than helping themselves. So I think, Caroline, you're very on the money that we need in the longer term to take a balanced view of this. And that it's, you know, sometimes Mark Fried calls us evangelists of it. But really, I do agree that as we go forward, that we'll have opportunities to think about, as you say, the dark side or maybe we have to get even closer.
Yeah, I sat in on a lecture last night by, I don't know if many of you have come across him, Arthur Steiner, who's at Glasgow Palais. So he did his professorial inaugural last night. And it was really interesting, the work that he's engaged in, because Arthur as well very much works with kind of local communities. And he was part of, I suppose, our circle as well when we were building up. But I mean, Arthur touches on some of these things as well. And I think there is, I think it is that balanced view that needs to be taken.
So you raised an interesting point there about, do we need to get even closer? I mean, what are the methodological implications of this kind of work, do you think? I mean, you know, how do we get closer in practical terms?
Well, Ed and I would, Ed, do you want to? I saw you.
I'll kick off and then you can finish off. It's actually thinking about getting closer to the people who are maybe supporting entrepreneurship. You find that, I'm totally talking about Dublin. Dublin is trying to put a matrix on the rural, and they're trying to tell them to grow yourself like Silicon Valley. And it's not actually Silicon Valley. And so really, I think getting closer is actually getting closer to the world of the interface between the entrepreneurs and those that are sort of supporting them.
Yeah, and I think that's good. We have all taken that kind of ethnographic perspective, I suppose, through a lot of our work as well. Not easy to do just now, obviously, although, you know, I see talk about digital ethnography. But certainly that's, you know, from a researcher's point of view, that's what we would probably aspire to do.
Yeah.
We were doing this work, which we do anyway, that's into the art thing, as we're very much kind of informed by ethnographics.
Etsia, did you have a question, or are you busy applauding?
I have lots of questions, a headache, I'm busy applauding, and I'm not sure where to begin. But I'll try my best. I think let me give you some background to this. When I came back from maternity leave, this is now 2018, we did an audit of every single issue of JBV, ETP, and SEJ, dating back 10 years. And we looked at every single paper that looked at early stage entrepreneurship through, and basically the criteria we use for sampling early stage entrepreneurship. And when you look at that, and basically considering these three journals, like the example of what the field officially recognizes in terms of mainstream top level outlets, you realize that the way we sample entrepreneurship completely leaves out the type of communities and the type of entrepreneurial activity and processes that you have been describing there. I mean, at least this is what we found. Maybe our sampling was not set correctly, but we're looking at very, very early stage. And what we seem to observe there was this idea that you, in order to be recognized before you have even registered as an entrepreneur, you know, or you have to somehow be caught in one of the mainstream, well, I call them mainstream, I don't know how else to describe them, entrepreneurial ecosystems that are recognized as such. And I'm not an entrepreneurial ecosystem person, so apologies to anyone who feels offended by that. So we found that, for example, craft industries were not included, arts industries were not included, a number of those, they just could not be included because of the sampling criteria we use. So then my question is, how do we sample this activity when it's in its inception? Because there will be, I imagine, community dynamics that dictate the inception of the entrepreneurial activity differently than perhaps the routes we are currently familiar with, you know, like you have the intention, you go to an incubator, all this kind of stuff. That's one thing. And then when we were doing work that we recently had accepted actually this Monday on Journal of Small Business Management, what we found is that some communities of, in this case, artists, they have this strong bond to, maybe not so much, in this case, was strong bond to the art school, so maybe not so much place, but community, outright de-identify and despise, again, what they would see as mainstream entrepreneurial networks. And therefore, they would actively choose not to engage with those. And therefore, I feel that we are having separate conversations and separate groups that never really integrate, resulting in theorizing that it's only on one facet of the entrepreneurial population when I think about in terms of process of understanding the process of the of entrepreneurship, the entrepreneurial journey from early on. I know I'm rambling on a lot, but I just wanted to get your thoughts on all of this.
No, carry on. I mean, I think when you mentioned craft, I noted today that there's an oral studies call, I'm sure it's oral studies call for papers around crafts, craft industry and organisations. So, you know, that's maybe something to note. So maybe things are starting to change at last. But I think as well, maybe it depends on the journals, I suppose. I mean, certainly I think that there's a more sort of European tradition, which would probably include place and community within that. But you're right, there's not a lot. I mean, when we were writing the GBV paper, that's when we kind of noticed that things were maybe starting to turn. And that community was maybe kind of coming in more to the way that people were looking at things. But again, I suppose it's difficult because depending on the way that you approach things, you know, it can add another complexity. But certainly, I mean, we would argue that, through my work, I would argue that, you know, it's relevance, especially. And I lost some of your question in there, I'm afraid.
Thank you.
And did you, when you talked about the review that you did you take that anywhere, or was it just an internal thing, internal project that you were doing it for?
So that would be, no, that was meant to be a paper actually targeted at JBV, which eventually, because of things got disrupted, I had to pause and is about to be resumed. And I guess what you just told me today encourages me to resume that paper, because as of where things stood in 2018, and I'm talking about only empirical work we sampled. Obviously, there were signs that things were starting to turn in terms of conceptual work, but empirical work that was looking at very early stage process. So, and again, that's a problematic issue in itself, right? To sample what's an early stage process. But
I capture that. I mean, capturing it can be, you know, outside of engagement, then it's, you know, it can be difficult. And often, I suppose, that's where, if you're embedded in an area where you're doing research, it's more easy to kind of spot things or hear about things.
Exactly, and that's exactly it. That mm-hmm. Then in the absence of that, you have to go by, GEM data, and even the way GEM data is sampled.
I don't think I've
understood. So yeah, but anyway, that data set is now 3 years old, and I'm about to stop dating that, which is a thankless job. But yeah, I think what you just said encourages me that hopefully there's more to sample in this other.
Yeah, what would be of interest to me as well there is that those three journals that you mentioned, JBV, ETP, SEG, they both had changes in editors.
Yep.
You know, within this time. So it'd be interesting as well to see, and I know that ETMP is becoming much more receptive to qualitative work, especially in the type of work that you know, a number of us in this room would do. I think it could be interesting just to see, you know. So do carry on.
Thank you both for that. That was wonderful and deep and interesting. And we have a question from James, which I'm going to have to read. James is visiting from our Department of Work, Employment and Organisation. Hi James, nice to see you. He's out on his bike and can't actually read it himself, so I shall do the honours. He's interested in some thoughts on inequalities of place and ideas of poverty of place and how to recognise those in these conversations. He's thinking of Glasgow, for example, where we see inequalities of place intersecting with other issues, often rubbing close to one another in a geographic sense. And that's something, of course, that your team knows lots and lots about. Alistair Anderson, and not a lot of you will know this, once had a textiles factory in the East End, in Shettleston. There you go. A poverty inequalities of place, Sarah. How do we speak to that?
Yeah, and I think that's interesting. I don't think that's coming in work enough at the moment. But having said that, from an editor's perspective, I'm starting to see a an increasing amount of work coming in, not lots, looking at poverty, but not in terms of how you kind of described it here, James. But I do think that there's space for that. And I don't know, maybe some work in regional studies would kind of cover that, and the work that the regional economic geographers do as well, would maybe speak to that. But I do think there's room for that. And I think it is an interesting, and we can all reflect on where we, you know, I'm thinking of where Ed grew up, where I grew up, where, you know, even in these small communities, you've got the rich and the poor. But it is, yeah, an interesting point. I think there is work to be done here as well.
Indeed.
I do wonder as well with, you know, I keep, maybe it's just my hope, my optimistic outlook, I suppose. But, you know, one of the things that the pandemic, because I saw that there was starting to be people talking about, you know, situating themselves in areas where perhaps they grew up, which might be more rural, more peripheral, when they were running their businesses because of technology and the way you could do that. But a project which actually Suzanne is also involved in, but I'm involved in as well, Suzanne Wilson, around COVID-19 and entrepreneurship. What's interesting, I think, there from the work that the Lancaster team have been doing is that you could see, you know, people who would normally be based in a city doing their work are now running their businesses from their country house in the Lake District or, you know, a rural part of Sweden. So you've got these changes coming in as well, and maybe COVID-19 will help from that perspective. But I do think in Sorensen's work always kind of brings me back to this point, because he speaks to the fact that at the end of the day, you know, not everybody wants to be working in a Silicon Valley. And that actually people, particularly when they start building their families and their lives, want to be somewhere where they have family networks or they have social networks, which they can use to support them, an emotional network, not just always as an entrepreneur or a business owner. And often that means returning to the places where people grew up. And I think as well, if you think about the paper that we did with Ed, that was in James, and that paper there kind of drew on that as well, the fact that people wanted to remain where they were and do something, you know, do good by place.
And we have generations. Something that we've noticed in class and also in some of our research groups is that there's a large part of Britain that doesn't have a village in the sense that a Greek or an Italian, or I know, and it was when we were talking about family as part of our deep departments, kind of pastoral care for each other, and we realized that a lot of people in Britain don't have that rural place to go back to after these generations, and what a lack of resource that is for them. Jackie's asking what our thoughts are on the extent to which the dark side might be explained by social pressure to conform. So like collectively prescribed obligations versus what the entrepreneur feels their obligations might be. So like artists avoiding incubators. Is that around social pressure to conform rather than individual agency?
Yeah, so where there might be conflicting feelings of obligations and therefore avoidance.
I suspect it might be a bit of both, and that, you know, maybe a lot of it does come down to the individual. And I suppose incubators only, the kind of incubator environment only really works at the moment anyway for maybe specific types of businesses. And maybe that depends on the support that's being provided through government agencies. And I don't know, I mean, I don't know enough about the artists, but, and I probably should, but, you know, maybe they have their own kind of comings together, which is more kind of like a social incubator rather than the more kind of traditional view that we take on incubation.
So they may have incubators that match
their needs.
Their needs of even towards, you know, moral obligation. Yeah. Or moral obligation to the artistry, I suppose.
Yeah, and just more kind of informal support. Because I suppose it's difficult, isn't it? Because artists have such personal styles as well. And that's how they're often known, by their personal style.
Juliet, do come in.
Hi, Sarah. Thank you so much for that. It was a question you alluded to at the beginning. Your thoughts on how digital impacts on our understanding of place. and whether place has to be a sort of physical thing, and how the digital environment sort of broadens our understanding of what that might be.
Yeah, I mean, I think, and it was interesting when I was looking for photographs for, you know, to add into the presentation today, and the extent and the amount of ones that you could see, which, you know, always related to a kind of physical place more than anything else. But I suppose the digital world is a space, isn't it? And I suppose, I mean, this here today is a space that we're all kind of talking and playing in. So is it the Zoom place? The Hexum place? Sorry, HC place? But yeah, I suppose there is that kind of move as well, isn't there? And I think this is what I thought was quite interesting about this digital ethnography idea as well. That, you know, I suppose we're finding new ways to gather data. I mean, I know that Recirculate, the project with Africa that Nigel's been involved in, when the pandemic struck, you know, it was very difficult to kind of have the physical meetings as such. So, I mean, the WhatsApp chat groups are so lively. Would they have been there if we weren't in the situation that we're in today? I suspect not.
McKeever's just quietly sitting there and then dropping these beautiful one-liners into the chat. So he's asking, can places incubate? And then just sitting back and smiling. I'm conscious that we've got 5 minutes and some folk will need to get themselves off to meetings and possibly have a 2-second screen break between that. So if anybody who needs to disappear at one has a question, could you let us know now or forever after, hold your peace? Good, then we can just chill and wrap up in this relaxed fashion. If just before people do start dropping out and heading for the next meeting, can I one more time on behalf of the whole department thank everybody so, so much, and especially Ed and Sarah for being here. And we've got representatives from, I think, almost all the departments in the business school, which is fantastic, and beyond. Marketing's here, WIO is here, it's great. Lovely to see you all. Do please, a great big thank you, Sarah. Just this, if Abdullah was here, he would be using the superstar appellation, which he keeps for his very, very, very special seminar guest. And it's only been awarded, I think, so far to big Alistair Anderson. And to David Aldrich, and you were definitely in that. So there you go. That will make you feel wonderful about yourself. I suggest that we stop recording now, Eloise, and just chat for as long as people have to stay.